once it was understood that there was something to do with pressure on the median nerve in the wrist, even though at the time in the early 50s, they had not yet established the exact pressure in the carpal tunnel. Then surgery was done through a transverse incision at the wrist. There were a lot of problems with that because of different surgical skills, the different surgeons using it, a lack of full understanding of anatomy, et cetera, that we now have. So a lot of people were getting an injury to one of the branches of the nerve that would give them permanent numbness here and an exquisite irritation here from what's called a neuroma of the palmar cutaneous branch. The other problem was incomplete release of the ligament because it goes down about an inch or an inch and a half in the palm. And if the person wasn't careful enough and didn't perfectly release it, the patient would continue to have pressure on the nerve. So two main problems. So in the early 70s, surgeons taking care of people with carpal tunnel syndrome started making an incision down the midline. And even in a fairly modern book, there's people doing incisions way up into the forearm. Anatomists have unequivocally confirmed that the problem is in this small area right here. So anything exceeding this area is not necessary anyway. In about 1980, fiber optic equipment became available, known as an arthroscope. And from what we started using in orthopedics, it's branched off in all sorts of areas of medicine. And in 1980, to advance our basically care of the patient by using smaller incisions, allowing less damage while releasing necessary things or taking things out through small incisions. And in 1986, Dr. Akutsu in Japan did some really nice research using conventional arthroscopy equipment that's used on the knee. First he measured the patient's carpal tunnel pressure. Then he did the electrodiagnostic studies to confirm unequivocally that they had a pinched nerve and the findings of that. And then he created endoscopic technique for releasing the transverse carpal ligament via the small incision in the wrist as opposed to in the palm. And he did a follow-up study a couple of years later showing that you really need to release two layers, not just one, to get everyone with the problem fully treated. And that's really important because a manufacturer, Fortune 500 company, went around promoting a technique that only released one ligament. And there were a lot of failures from that because a lot of people who really probably shouldn't have been doing carpal tunnel surgery in the first place were doing it, not understanding this anatomic issue or the research that went into it. So there was immediate abandonment by many doctors for even offering the technique. Now that, plus they're fearful because they're not used to working in this environment with a scope. They're used to seeing everything splayed open. The problem is, the more tissue you release, the more soreness the person has. It's been demonstrated that there's a load of sensory nerve fibers in the subcutaneous fat. And when a person has an incision going all the way through four layers, we're damaging those nerves, causing more pain. The other problem with a conventional carpal tunnel is done open is that if a person grips firmly, the wound has a tendency to pop open. And we call it a wound dehiscence. And that's a devastating problem for a person who can get infected. If you go back to the doctor, if it's on clothes or off their work. And the combination of more discomfort to begin with, a wound that will pop open if you grip firmly, plus a visible scar, sometimes it's a hypertrophic scar in a person. All those are really deterrents to wanting to do a conventional carpal tunnel release. If we try and do a carpal tunnel release through about a 1 to 1.5 centimeter incision, which is basically 3/4 of an inch, it's very difficult. I used to do them that way before the endoscopic technique became available. Then you get the risk of incomplete release and then our failed carpal tunnel release, so added discomfort, cost, etc. If an endoscopic technique is applied properly, the success rate is extremely good and the discomfort very low. If you give the person the right medication to prevent discomfort and or treat it afterwards, and I'm not talking about anything habituating, and do the surgery right, most people can go back to work the same day or the next day. And that's been my experience actually in the past 30 years and the world experience. And this has been reported in the medical literature is that patients universally prefer the endoscopic technique. There have been studies with on one hand, they'd have the open technique, the other hand, the endoscopic technique. There's about 6 or 8 techniques at least doing this endoscopically. There's been no added benefit to making it a one incision technique in the upper wrist or the palm versus a 2-incision technique. The amount of minor discomfort and the impact it has on a person's life is identical. It's just a very good technique.